Welcome to the online broadcast of the Calvary Temple Community Church of Barbados.
Thank you. Lord, good morning and welcome to our CTCC Online Church, Calvary Temple Community Online Church. And of course, we're located right here in Groves, Six Roads, St. Philip, in the beautiful island of Barbados. It's great to come on into your house, into your home, into your heart, and we're thankful that we can bring the gospel of Jesus Christ right on in. So God bless you, wherever you're located, you're on our Facebook page or perhaps on our YouTube page, wherever you're getting this medium today, we say to you, God bless you, and thank you so much for joining us for our online church. I want to shout out all of our members, first of all of the Calvarians, God bless you, amen and amen. Jump on there on the chat. Let's get some people on the feed. Invite some persons to church this morning. This is our online church. Just now we're getting ready to go back into the building. So let's maximize this platform before we add to it the return to the house of the Lord. And all of the rest of Barbados, right across the parishes, those of you who are not necessarily directly connected with Calvary, but you're affiliated, we thank you for your friendship. We thank you for your camaraderie, for coming on in there and building up the community, the Calvary community, and helping the gospel to reach to the ends of the world right across the region. We bless you this morning and right across to the rest of the globe. We say it is good to get together with you this morning. Amen. We are into a new month. Welcome to the month of July it is. And I just want to say that the first half of the year is behind us and the second half of the year is now ahead of us. So however you played the first half and you know you made some mistakes, make sure that you correct those mistakes now and play the second half of the game. Amen. This is halftime. It's a good time to regroup, get your thoughts together, pick up from where you may have dropped off, and get busy for the glory of God for the second half of 2020. And we trust the Lord that it will be a better second half than the first half. Somebody ought to go on in the chat and say amen. Praise the Lord. So this wonderful month of July, I should also add that this is the best month. Huh? Let me just drop that there and move on quickly. The best month. Best month of the year. Here we are in the month of July. And I want to, on that note, shout out everybody who's got a birthday going on. All of the birthday July born, God bless you, beginning with me, hallelujah, best month of the year, and all the July borns, come on, don't leave me alone on this, get into the chat there on YouTube, Facebook, wherever you are, let me know that you are also a July born, something special about us. Amen. And anniversaries, if you know you were married there during the course of this month, happy anniversary to you. Any members that we have like that, it's your anniversary. We want to connect with you. And in the interest of time, just to shout out all husbands and wives everywhere who will be celebrating their anniversaries during the course of this wonderful month of July. And let me highlight quickly the drive-in church experience just last Sunday. What an amazing time was had. I tell you something, it was superb, unforgettable. A glorious occasion was afforded us, and I believe sincerely that the Lord put his signature on the event when last week Sunday, could have started the way it did with pockets of heavy showers, and by the time we got to the end of the day, we had a cloudless sky. I mean, what a way, what a day to be able to host that drive-in experience. It was phenomenal. And I want to shout out everybody who had a hand in it and making it a success, the success that it was. So I say to you, God bless you and thank you so much for making it a tremendous and a memorable, unforgettable event. That drive-in church experience was the inaugural one here in the island. Of course, we've got several people all over the world who've done this, several pastors on an international scale. But it was good for us as Calvary Temple Community Church here in Barbados to be able to get it done and to be the first, as far as we know, in Barbados to pull that off. And there's another one coming up. So get ready for the drive-in church experience reloaded. Dice reloaded, July 12th, 6:30 p.m. That's next week Sunday, not this evening, but next week Sunday, July 12th, 6:30 p.m. Get thy holy self ready for that. And you should plan to come early. You may have seen some of the footage in, like, for example, the Nation newspaper. I think there was one article there. You saw a picture 30 minutes ahead of the drive-in experience, 30 minutes before we started, and scores of persons on the ground securing their vantage points. We would not want you to miss that opportunity, so plan to be early for next Sunday, 6:30 p.m. And let's pray for good weather. Amen? Let's declare it again. Put it out there in the atmosphere. Let all the storms and tropical waves know that we are saying good weather is necessary for us here in the Island of the Sun, July 12th, next Sunday, 6:30 p.m. All righty. So I want to open with a word of prayer and hurry up and get out of the way. Our sister, Faye Merle, is going to be leading us in worship momentarily. And then this young man, Nathan, he's going to be bringing his ministry in song. We bless this young man. So many people, young and old alike, enjoy this young man's ministry. And every time that he ministers, you get a whole lot of chat going on there, and they can't wait to have him again. So stay tuned. You're going to have ministry from Nathan right after our worship set. And then I come back to you with the rich word of the Lord today. We're talking about storm preparedness, storm readiness. You do not want to miss that. It's a potent message and a timely one, storm readiness, as we approach the end of the age. And then, of course, our communion table, and then we're out of your way. So, Father in God, we bless your name today. We thank you for your tender mercies, your love towards us. We thank you that you do all things well. We ask for your crowning glory on this first Sunday of a brand new month as we move into the second half of this year. And we decree and declare that the favor of the Lord is upon us. God, get all the honor, get all the glory. We thank you, Lord, for the online community. And as we prep ourselves to return to the building, the physical edifice, God, we declare it shall be well with our souls. And we're not looking for a soft reopening. We're looking for a hard reopening. That's a big reopening, one in which we can declare, look what the Lord has done in joining the physical congregation with the online virtual platforms. So God, we say you are an awesome God, and we love you. Father God, Holy Spirit, we bless you. We need you, for we can do nothing without you. And Lord Jesus, we thank you not only for your death, but for your resurrection and the fact that you're coming again to rapture us home to glory. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray this way. I ask God that men and women and boys and girls would receive healing in their bodies this morning, that they would receive a touch from on high, not just a message from the Word of God, not just a song or song sung unto the King of Kings, not just the ministry that you could get on any platform, but I'm asking God that you would touch and that you would heal the hearts of men, that lives would be changed, and that men and women would declare, as it was for the drive-in church experience where persons got healed on those grounds, I ask God that somebody would get healed in this service today, this online service, and that they would share what they received with someone else and spread the good news in this dark and benighted generation. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray this way. Amen. And amen. Let me also shout out the junior church department. I've been taking time out every Sunday just to shout out some of the departments. But I want to just shout out this one department today. All of you who are part and parcel of our junior church, as we get together with those young people, some of them are not preschoolers. They are primary schoolers, and then some of them are just now into secondary school here in Barbados. I want to bless those children. I want to, in the name of Jesus, bless them, bless their parents, bless their families, their households, and the teachers that make junior church a reality. So, Sister Dinah Lord and all of the junior church staff, more power to you in Jesus' mighty name. Sister Sarah McLean, one of our key teachers as well, who always leads us along in the Zoom chat there whenever we get together for our Zoom Junior Church. Amen and amen. Let me get out of the way and welcome at this time our sister Faye Merle as we go to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on, give him praise this morning.
A blessed good morning to each and every one of you. My name is Faye Merle, and we are coming to you live from the Calvary Temple Community Church in the beautiful island of Barbados. And I must tell you, it has been beautiful these past few days. Yes, we've been getting some showers, but that's only lended to aid the beauty. Oh, when we drive around the island, we see the greenery. And I am excited. Why? Because we're no longer on lockdown. So we can drive around at our leisure. We can shop at our pleasure. Oh my goodness. It has been a good week. We just give God thanks and praises for bringing us safely thus far. This morning, we just want to lift up the name of the Most High God, to magnify him, to exalt him. So before we get into worship, just go ahead and invite somebody to right now come on to this stream with you. If you're on YouTube, just click on that subscribe button. If you're over on Facebook, just click on that share button. And I also want you to go ahead and just let those emojis fly up the screen. How many of you know that sound? Glorious. Glorious. We've come to lift up the name of the Most High God and to make his praise glorious. That's why we were created. So let's sing it loudly in our bedrooms, in our dining rooms, wherever we are. Let's make the name of the Lord sound out in righteous praises this morning. Hallelujah. Lifting up the name of Jesus, and you hear the music playing, and you see the people praising. Just forget about your worries, let your troubles fall behind you. Don't you wait another minute, just get up and on your feet and get to dancing, singing, jumping, leaping, get shouting, make it loud and make it glorious. Lifting, praising, get shouting, make it loud and make his praise glorious, glorious. Hallelujah. We're going to go from the top again, yes? Let's lift up the name of the Most High God. When we come into his presence, lifting up the name of Jesus, and you hear the music playing, and you see the people praising, just forget about your worries. Your troubles fall behind you. Don't you wait another minute. Just get up and on your feet. Let me see you dancing where you are. Hallelujah. Leaping, get to shouting, make it loud and make it glorious. Just start rejoicing, praising. Come on. Get to shouting, make it loud. Created to praise God wherever you are. Let's see the moves going on now. Let me see the moves.
I was created to make his praise glorious. Woo! I was created to make his praise glorious, glorious. Yes, I was. Yes, you were.
Trials and the tribulations, through all of these restrictions that we had with COVID-19, if there is one thing that kept playing back in my mind, is that tomorrow is not promised. You just got to take one day at a time. Amen. This song brings it home nicely for you. Lord, help me believe in you and in all that you can do. Yesterday is gone. I can't change yesterday. I can't predict my future, but I can handle today. So Lord, help me to get through today, one day at a time.
Day with you as the captain of our ship, we can weather any storm. God bless you.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen. precious blood of Jesus hooks to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness is God's proof. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. Treasure you found, Jesus is calling. Jesus is calling.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Nathan, for your ministry this morning. Thank you, Faye, for bringing us as well to this place in our online service this first Sunday in the month of July. We say that the Lord has been good to us, and we thank God for these ministers of the gospel who sacrifice their time and who hear from the Lord even in their song selections and the delivery thereof. I want to direct your attention today to St. Matthew's Gospel, the 24th chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel, reading from verse 1 through to 12, and I would title this message, if I had to find a title, Storm Readiness. Storm Readiness, a biblical view of the end times. And I seek to use today's message as the beginning of perhaps a three-part series on this theme of the end times. Very important series it is, and I think you can fully appreciate that based on the direction that the world is currently heading in. Jesus went out, verse 1 through to 12, Matthew 24, and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Let me just press pause there to say, at least those disciples were a little bit more keen on knowing what was happening or what was going to be happening at the end of the age. I find that interesting. These disciples way back then were a little bit more spiritual, apparently, and interested in knowing what the end times might look like than the disciples of today, even though we are closer to the end now than they were then. Continuing on in verse 4, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Verse 5 and following, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And he shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. And these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. Verse 12. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. The theme today is that of the beginning of Jacob's trouble. The beginning of Jacob's trouble. This morning, we commence this important series, as I mentioned, in what the Bible has to say about the end times and the events that will take place as God's redemptive plan unfolds for mankind. We begin by looking at a period of time known as the time of Jacob's trouble. This phrase is found in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 6 and 7, and you can check it out on your own. I have a number of scriptures and references, all of which I will not read because it is not that nature or type of service today. But I will give you the references, so you're going to have a lot of homework to do after this morning's message. Jeremiah 30, verse 6 to 7, these verses, Jacob, or otherwise known of as the nation of Israel, is portrayed as a man who is about to give birth. A man who is about to give birth. This man is suffering great pains and is bowed down in agony. The Bible tells us that there are no days to compare with those that Israel, or Jacob, must endure. However, verse 7 shows us that Israel will be saved out of those days. By way of introduction, then, consider two major reasons for this stormy, troubling time known of as the Great Tribulation. The Great Tribulation. Number one, first of two major reasons for it, would be to punish the Gentile nations. Romans 1, verse 18. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12 to 13, Revelation 19, verse 15. You see those references there at the bottom of your screen. Romans 1, 18, 2 Thessalonians 2, 12 to 13, and Revelation 19, verse 15. For thousands of years, men have spurned the call of God to repentance and salvation. After the rapture of the church and during the tribulation period, God will allow a wicked, irreverent humanity to be visited with the fruits of their sins. The fruits of their sins. In other words, divine judgment will be pronounced upon the Gentile nations for the purpose of punishment. Secondly, the second reason for the stormy, troubling time will be to purge the people of Israel. To purge the people of Israel. Ezekiel 20, verse 37 and 38. Zechariah 13, verse 8 and 9. Malachi chapter 3, verse 3. The nation of Israel is guilty of rejecting the Messiah and having a part in his death. However, God will use the terrors of the tribulation to prepare Israel for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see how good God is? You see how good God is? He will use the terrors of the tribulation period to prepare the nation, the beloved nation of Israel, for his second coming. And understand then, in that vein, that when Jesus returns to the earth, this is his second coming, when he returns to the earth, his church, his blood-washed bride, will be with him. For 1,000 years, we return with him, and his feet, the Bible tells us, will touch the Mount of Olives. The last place that his feet touched before he was taken up in Acts 1, verse 11, will be the first place that his feet will touch when he returns with the bride of Christ. And this is, of course, 7 years or so after the rapture would have taken place. And he comes back with us, thank God. He comes back with us to an earth that will be completely different. For 1,000 years, I'm looking forward to that. I tell you, there are great days ahead and many rewards if you live for God. It is apparent that he will be met by a believing remnant then of Jewish people at that time on the earth. And for 1,000 years, peace, absolute peace, will reign. And of course, the devil would be put away during that period of time. I want to say that I will be covering some frightening material momentarily during the course of this series. However, we need to hear these things, beloved. We need to hear these things because there are those who may be viewing this morning who've never repented. They've never taken time to repent of their sins and have never believed on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. They are not storm ready. They are not storm ready. If you're listening to this preacher today and you're in that condition, should Christ return for his blood-washed bride, for his church, the redeemed, in your lifetime, you will face some of these things that will be discussed during the course of this message this morning. To be forewarned is to be forearmed. Please take copious notes. It becomes apparent then that those of us who are saved will not be here for even 1 second of the tribulation. Thank God. Thank God for that. But we too need to hear about these things. Why? Because we need our hearts stirred once again. We need our hearts stirred about what the lost of this world will face. We need to realize that the responsibility of reaching this world before the tribulation rests on the shoulders of the redeemed people of God. It is my responsibility as much as it is yours. It's not just for the preacher or the pastor or the evangelist, the prophet. No, it is for everybody who names the name of Christ. We have got to warn a world that will be deemed wicked if they do not repent of their sins. May the Lord use these truths then to stir our hearts to action, that we might help others to get storm ready. Consider with me how tribulation starts. Look at how the worst storm ever known to man will develop. The worst storm. And I tell you, it's the worst storm because the tribulation period after the 7 years will end with something called the Battle of Armageddon. And the Bible says no war or battle has ever been fought on the face of this earth at any time in any generation as bad and as terrible as the Battle of Armageddon will be. Christ himself will have to come back in order to bring it to a stop. And that's what will happen when he returns with us for those 1,000 years that I talked about earlier, called the millennial reign. So I want you to ask yourself today, if you and your loved ones are ready for this, are you storm ready for this tribulation, for this stormy time, for this trouble of Jacob, as is found in Scripture? This storm is the Great Tribulation, and it will be a terrible time. In Matthew 24, verse 1 to 12, Jesus tells his inquiring disciples about some of the events that will transpire during the course of the tribulation. Since these words are first spoken to the disciples, they are a message then to the nation of Israel primarily. But there are still lessons here from which we can learn and grow, and we would be silly to not learn and grow as we aim to be storm ready and trouble free. The first half of the tribulation will be a time of devastation, the first 3.5 years. It will be marked by a dearth of spirituality and a decrease in the stability of societies all over the world. Look around you and you'll see the stage already being set. The stage is already being set. Note the following then from our text this morning. 3 points that I leave with us. The first of which from verse 7. The superstorm will be marked by despair. This superstorm will be marked by despair. And even now, if you really lean on into the text, I'm sure you can probably hear and see some of the effects that this superstorm is bringing in your direction. Even now, in this stream, you can feel, you can sense, see and hear what this superstorm is beginning to look like as it forms on the horizon of humankind. According to this verse in 7, there will be famine during the tribulation. This is again made even clearer by the words of the Revelator. Listen to the book of Revelation, chapter 6, verse 5 to 6. This one I will read for you. And it reads, "When he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, 'Come and see.' So I looked, and behold, a black horse." Here we go. Here we go. "A black horse. And he who sat on it had a pair of scales." Come on now. "A pair of scales in his hand." Watch it. Watch it. "And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, 'A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine.'" It probably repeated itself. "A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine." A careful look at these verses reveals the black horse speaks of death. Please make a note of that. The black horse is an illustration. Much of the writing is metaphoric, speaking here of death. The pair of scales refer to a careful rationing of food. A careful rationing of food. There will be a food shortage. Watch it. Watch it. A denarius, which was the Roman penny, was a day's wages. That day's pay, day's wage, that Roman penny or denarius would purchase about 8 quarts of wheat. Watch it. You're going to learn something this morning. Welcome to CTCC. 8 quarts of wheat a denarius could purchase. Or a denarius could purchase 24 quarts of barley. So picture yourself going on into the supermarket, the one nearest to you this morning, and you're picking up 8 quarts of wheat. 1 denarius would cover that. Or maybe a 24 pack of barley. 24 quarts of barley. And you go to the checkout register this morning, or maybe tomorrow morning, because most people don't shop on Sundays. And when you get to the register, the lady would tell you, all things being equal, "A denarius, sir, ma'am, 1 penny for those 24 quarts of barley." I want you to connect that reality with what it will be in the day when Jacob's trouble comes on our doorstep. When Jacob's troubles come on the doorstep of this world, when that storm hits home, when you begin to feel the effects of the stormy weather that I'm talking about, when the great tribulation comes, if you are left behind and you're not raptured and taken out of this dark, twisted, corrupt world in the rapture, you will be left behind for Jacob's trouble. You will have to go through the tribulation. You will have to endure this super storm that I'm talking to you about. And I want you to understand that the food rationing is going to be such that everything will be cut by 1/8. Think about that. Everything will be cut by 1/8. Instead of you getting your 24 quarts of barley, you will only, based on what the Bible says, not Pastor Simmons, the Bible says, you will only be able to get 3. For your 1 denarius, for your 1 penny, you will only be able to walk away from that supermarket with 3 quarts of barley. instead of you being able to purchase 8 quarts of wheat, you will only, in that day, you will only be able to walk away with 1 quart of wheat, whereas your money would have been able to get you 8. I'm saying to you that the food supply will be 1/8. Everything will be cut, divided by 8, compared to what it normally would be. Question, do you really want to be around this place for that mess? Think about that. Think about you. Think about your household, sir, ma'am. Think about feeding your 4 children or 6. Some of you got 8. Think about having to feed all those mouths, including your own, when food rationing is going on. Do you really want to be around here for that? Continuing, we see the writer, however, is told not to hurt the oil or the wine. The oil or the wine. What is it about this oil and this wine, Pastor? I'm so glad you asked. It appears that luxury items enjoyed by the rich will not be harmed. This is the oil and this is the wine. Sadly, the average person in the street will not be able to buy these commodities at that time. If they aren't growing these things in their backyard, some people already start doing that, boy. If they aren't growing these things in their backyard, they'll run the risk of starvation. And that's going to be our reality. Well, I shouldn't say our, because I plan to be out of this place. I said I plan to be out of this place. I told you already, I am not looking for the undertaker. I am looking for the upper taker. Hallelujah. Anybody looking for the upper taker this morning? Give God praise right where you are. Out there in the patio, out there in your open room, living room, dining room, in your bedroom, kitchen area. Give God glory if you know that you're looking for the upper taker, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Any minute now, we're going home to be with the Lord. So this is the reality for those who are left behind. We are already seeing these things taking shape. This world has never been so populated before. Much of the land that was once used to grow food has now been transformed into places for people to work and live. And you know what I'm talking about. Given this current trajectory, our world will soon face genuine food shortages. It's taking place already. You only have to open your eyes and see what's going on, and you will realize God is wrapping things up here in the earth. During the tribulation, these things will just get worse and worse. Question coming at you again. Do you really want to be still here for that mess, for that superstorm of biblical epic proportions? Secondly, coming from the same 7th verse, this superstorm will be marked by disaster. Even now, you're seeing the signs of it. Even now, you're hearing a semblance of it. This superstorm is furious. This superstorm is as wicked as they have ever been. If you think that Category 5 storms in our generation is something, you need to see the Category 7 that's about to come in your direction. You say, Pastor, what Category 7? There's no such thing as a Category 7. Oh, yes, there is. And if you open up your Bible and you start to read some of the things that I'm talking about to you this morning, you will also agree and identify there is a Cat 7 storm coming. Because 7 is the biblical number of completion. And God will use this storm of the tribulation to wrap everything up when he comes again. He will put his feet down on the Mount of Olives, and we come back with him, and he will shut down that battle of Armageddon, and the devil and the false prophet and the antichrist will be tossed, flung, thrown in once and for all into the lake of fire. You need to understand, God will be wrapping things up, bringing everything to a completion. That's why I use the number 7. This is the Category 7 superstorm, and I am making sure that I'm going to be prepared for it. On the right side, that's God's side, sir, ma'am. If you're not saved, this is a good time. It's a good day for you to get right with God. Hear what this preacher is saying to you today. This superstorm will be marked by disaster. Not only despair, but disaster. Jesus says that there will be earthquakes and natural disasters during these early years of the tribulation. The diseases and pestilences, which are also mentioned in verse 7, there are a given. I wouldn't even waste your time and mine to talk about them. We only have to pick up the newspaper, go online, all over the world. You can't escape the word pestilence these days. You can't escape the reality of diseases. So I'll just move on and not even deal with diseases and pestilences. We have no need to be reminded or convinced about the reality of pandemics or pestilences or diseases. Relative to the earthquakes then, the last century saw a dramatic increase in the number of earthquakes. Oh yeah. These earthquakes became very intense and they began to happen in places that earthquakes don't usually even take place. And that word there in the King James, I find it interesting. It says diverse places. You know, funny story. You know, many years ago, when I was just freshly saved, getting into the reading of the word of the Lord, and I came across diverse places. In my naivety, I thought that literally meant underneath the sea, because it said diverse places. Look, there it is. Diverse places. You see that? So I used to read it and even talk about it as earthquakes under the sea, because that's where the divers go. And then someone corrected me and told me that's an old English word that really means different. Diverse places, different places, a plethora of places. But the truth is that earthquakes do happen under the sea. So though I was wrong, I was still right. Amen. I just thought I'd throw that in for free this morning. These things are happening and they will keep on happening and they are increasing again and again as the years roll by. And they are simply setting the stage for what will happen in the future. I'm moving quickly this morning because I want to hasten to the communion table. I'm not going to be long. Moving to the final point from verse 10 and verse 12. Thirdly, the superstorm will be marked by disobedience. The superstorm will be marked by disobedience. This tribulation period, this time of Jacob's trouble, this superstorm will be marked by despair, disaster, and disobedience. I leave those three with you today. I could give you more, but that will suffice because I'm beginning a series, so I can always come back to this next Sunday. And I know that you'll join me and bring some others with you online. These verses here in 10 and 12 seem to indicate that the tribulation will be marked by a total disregard for the sanctity of life, for property, or for the rights of others. And that's the truth. And you know that is true. Look around you, sir. Have you read the news lately? Look at the protests that continue and continue. And every time you think it's about to die down now because we got used to the reality that George Floyd died and how he died, here comes another story. Here comes another individual who was taken advantage of. And if it's not a man, it's a woman. And we go on and on and on. And you can think of some other examples as well in your own neck of the woods. Tribulation will be marked by a total disregard for the sanctity of life, property, or the rights of others. Listen, if you think that you're going to have human rights after the church is taken out of here, think again. Right now, it is the Spirit of God who is holding back the full-fledged work of the enemy. I mean the complete torment, the full full-fledged work of the enemy to destroy the mankind. It is only the grace of God and the goodness of the Spirit of God that is inhibiting all hell from breaking loose in what we know to be life today. So there is no thing as human rights. There are no human rights. Not after the church is raptured and taken out of this place. This is a good time, if you're not saved, to thank God for the church, because the Holy Spirit is only here because of the church. Don't mind how they treat the church. And you really don't want to start me on that. Don't mind how they treat the church. If it hadn't been for the church, you will see hell, brimstone, and you would catch some fire. It's only the church and the presence of the Spirit of God in her that's holding back all hell from busting loose. These two statements here then are clear. And I want you to see some things coming out of them. They'll betray one another. That's one. They'll betray one another and hate one another. And the second one, wickedness and the love of sin. Let me deal with the first one first. They'll betray one another and hate one another. Verse 10. The business of being betrayed and hated. This verse seems to indicate that men in that day will have no respect one for another. You think it's bad now? You ain't seen nothing yet. I told you that just now, and I'll say it again. It is about to get worse. It's about to get worse. Certainly, violent crimes will increase. That is for sure. And it's already happening. And many will die at the hands of their fellow men. That is already happening. Consider the recent heightened racial tensions. The manner in which injustices are carried out. Men against men and men against women, whether it is black on white or white on black or yellow or red, whatever color they are. This is the reality. This is the day our generation is marked by this behavior, the manner in which injustices are carried out and the ensuing knee-jerk reactions that follow as men seek their own revenge. Well, I don't have to park there. You've been watching the news. When all the while God has a better plan than for you to get revenge. And I'm speaking to folk today who need to understand. You don't have to go out there and get revenge. I understand the feeling that one must do something. I get that. Look good at me. Look at me good. And you can tell that I must understand the need to take a stand for all kind of wickedness that's going on. You must appreciate that. Look good at me. You see my color? But I want you to know something today. God has a better plan, sir. Hey, Korabaha. God has a better plan. Leave it to Beaver. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. God shall repay. And I want to tell you what somebody told me years ago. When God repays, it is a best. It is the best way to get the payment. Listen, because you get to keep your hands clean. Nobody can point fingers at you and say, look what you did, but you didn't have to do it that way. No, you keep your fingers clean. Keep your hands clean. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And when God repays, it is done better than you could ever hope to do it. It is done more thoroughly. It is done more exhaustively. It's done more completely. It's done more unilaterally. It's done in a way that the whole world will know God had to do this. And you can sit back with a cup of coffee, cross your legs, look out through the window, and rejoice in the fact that God stood up for you and that he came to the rescue of you, your family, and your entire kindred. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Of course, the population of the world is already being trained to disregard the life and rights of their fellow men. We know that. That begins in the classroom, yeah. When we live in a world that allows the murder of 55 million unborn children every year. You heard what I said. 55 million unborn children every year. That's what the stats look like. Wake up. There are the statistics. Can you imagine... my gospel, I can't even imagine a million. 55 million. All the gallons of innocent blood that have already been shed and spilled in the earth. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. But when we allow that type of behavior and we condone that type of behavior, it sends the message that life is without any value. And that's a wrong message that we need to be sending or putting our signature to. When we see an increase in euthanasia and other forms of mercy killing become accepted by the people of the world, we know that we have lost, as it were, our respect for human life, the sanctity of human life. It seems that we are not too many days then removed from seeing the elderly, the elderly, the mentally handicapped, and others being exterminated to prevent them from being a drain on society. And I have actually come across documentation that supports this. There are people with this mentality in our generation, don't fool yourself, in our culture, who would prefer to see the elderly and the disadvantaged, mentally handicapped and other handicaps removed from society so as to not put a drain on the society. What a thing. What a thing. And I ask this question this morning, and I ask you to put your thinking cap on. Is that not what this coronavirus sought to do? Now, you don't have to answer me, but I want you to think about that. Is that not what this COVID-19 coronavirus sought to do from the very beginning? And by now, please don't tell me that it is not crafted. Don't tell me that there wasn't a mastermind behind it crafting this thing for the purpose of depopulating. Don't tell me that, because by now the story is out. It's coming out. It's coming out. If you've been tracking anything or doing any kind of research, you can see the evidence of such coming to bear. Consider the aged and those with underlying health conditions. Listen to the categories. Listen to the categories. The who? The elderly, the aged. They tell us 65 years and up. And then some other part of the world, 70 years and up, the aged. And those with underlying health conditions, note how they were the most susceptible to the disease. How interesting is that? They were earmarked at the first. At the first. Why? Because potentially they are the ones seen as draining the system's resources. Now let me hasten to tell you, it gives me no pleasure to bring this type of news to you. I don't have any pleasure. There's no glory in me telling you these things. But somebody has to come to tell you these things. Struck against the backdrop of what we're reading in Matthew chapter 24, together with a plethora of other passages in both Old and New Testament, you have got to understand that these things need representation. And as we hasten to the tribulation period, and as we hasten to the end of the age, and as we come to grips with the fact that there is a super storm on the way, seeking to bring the demise of mankind, we have got to deal with these issues so as to ready the hearts of men and women, to ready the lives of boys and girls who, if they don't come clean with God, will be banished forever in a Christless eternity. This is the word of the Lord. When the world accepts the foolish notion that men evolved from lower life forms, that when he dies, he is like a dog that merely goes down to the grave. It becomes easy to take precious lives, friend. It becomes easy to take precious lives. If that is our thinking, if that's our mentality, it's easy for me to pick up a gun or sword and just cut you to pieces, a cutlass, an axe. It's easy. Because there's no life after this. You're nothing more than a dog. If men saw, however, one another as what they really are, unique creations, I say, according to the scripture, fearfully and wonderfully made, made in the image of God, it would prevent us from taking each other's lives. It would prevent us from doing stupid things that end in the taking of an innocent life, or any life for that matter. I want to hasten on to this final point found in verse 12. We talk in terms of wickedness and the love of sin. The tribulation will also see an increase in man's attraction to and indulgence in sin. We're still talking about the superstorm that will be marked by disobedience. Still talking about that third and final point, this superstorm being marked by disobedience, despair, disaster, and disobedience. And we understood from verse 10 that men will be betrayed, men will be hated one by another. And now we understand from verse 12, wickedness and the love of sin will abound. This tribulation will see that increase in the indulgence of sin. After the church is removed at the rapture, thank God, all restraints on society will be removed as well. No longer will there be the presence of a people who are filled with the precious Holy Spirit. No longer will there be a people on the earth who will pray for the society, who will pray for the nurses, who will pray for the doctors, who will pray for the teachers, who will pray for the ministers of government, who will pray for the sick, who will pray for the lame, trusting that they will walk again, who will pray for blind eyes to open, who will pray for deaf ears to unstop. No longer will there be anyone who will pray for the mute to speak again. Oh, the prayer warriors are gone home, taken out of the way. Do you really want to be here for that? I ask you that. I tell you, this is the generation that has to sit up and pay attention, because we are inching closer. Some say not inching, Pastor, we're racing to the toenails of time. And this is the end of the age as we know it. This is a sobering message. It's a sobering challenge. It's an acute challenge, bringing into sharp focus whether or not you're ready to meet your Creator. The world will continue its slide into a hot hell by following sin, damnable sins and heresies, with all the power that they possess. My prayer today, friend, as I close, is that you and I will stay focused. If you're a child of God, stay focused. You may have to put blinkers on, as you do with the horses on the racetrack. Here in Barbados is the Garrison Savannah. You may have to put some blinkers on so as not to get distracted with what's happening on your left, what's going on your right, what's happening behind you, who's saying what, what's saying who, who's with who has who. Keep your focus, because we are coming down to the last and closing day. I want to close and pause here today in this series. Next Sunday morning, God's willing, return to this important subject of end time storm readiness. In this capricious climate that we are journeying through, where men celebrate darkness more so than they do the light, we need to pray all the more earnestly, sir, ma'am, for ourselves, for our loved ones, and for them, for that generation, for the unsaved, for the wayfarer, for the person who is still lost, still indulging in all kind of messed up, all kind of sin, will not walk away from it, cannot break free. Bondage is a real thing. It will take the grace of God and faithful saints and the prayers of men and women, the righteous calling on God, knowing that when we do so, wonderful things take place at the hands and at the end of faithful prayers of righteous men and women. We've got to pray for them. And we've got to cover our families. And we've got to cover ourselves under the blood of Jesus Christ. This is not just a dark day. There is a storm on the way of biblical proportions. Last Sunday evening, on these copious grounds at Groves, we held the inaugural drive-in church experience. Several of you made it out for that. More power to you. God bless you. The first time for the church in Barbados, drive-in church experience it was. Almost 190 plus vehicles rallied around a novel way of reaching a novel generation for Christ. And I tell you something, there was nothing quite like it. I can't remember when last. Here in this country, overseas, yes, I've been to some wonderful things and had some great occasions. But here in this country, I can't remember the last time I had such an occasion. Oh, the glory of God condescended on these grounds. The atmosphere was rich. If you had a knife, as they say, you could cut it, man. You could feel the presence of God. Under his starry heaven, we worship the King of Glory. We worship, we praise, we fellowship, we sung songs, we said amen, we shouted hallelujah, horns beat, lights flashed. Oh, my gospel. Maybe you can see some of it now there on that screen. But most importantly, friend, before you get carried away, most importantly, after the word was preached, we prayed and we pledged before God and fellow man, that we would be lights in this dark world. That's what we did. We prayed and pledged that we would be lights in this benighted generation, which clearly, given all that we just heard in this message, is about to get darker and darker as the superstorm of Jacob's trouble approaches. Much like how it is in a real literal storm, you can see the clouds forming out to sea on the horizon. And it's not long before you actually feel the effects, the damning effects of a Category 5. Able to take out lives, able to take out some of the biggest, strongest buildings. They're like paperweights, man, in light of a Cat 5 storm. Just as how that is in the natural, so too it will be in the spiritual when we approach God's Cat 7. And we come to the end of the age and he brings everything to completion. My prayer is that you will get right with God. You will either get right or you will get left. I want to pray for us today. We must not only be lights in this world, we must also be voices in this benighted generation. If you're with your family at this time, and you can literally take that hand of the person to your left and to your right in your living room, in your patio, wherever you are, you're listening to this message now online, and you can take the hand of those persons to your left and to your right, do that. And I want to pray with you. By faith, I join my hands with yours. And I want you to see right now the chain reaction. Thousands of hands are being held. Certainly between now and next Sunday, thousands, I kid you not, of hands would have been held. And we're holding each other's hands. And the best part is that Jesus Christ's nail-pierced hands is holding up our hands. And he's drawing us in. I hear the Lord say that heaven is ready. All of the places of abode, the rooms are ready. But the saints are not. I hear the Lord say that though his heaven has been prepared, which is what he went to do, remember? I hear him say that the church is still not ready. And I want you to take this moment this morning, even before we come to that communion table, and determine in your heart that you will not be caught up in the storm that is on the way. Jacob's trouble will not be your trouble. I want to say that again for somebody who needs to declare that. Put that in the chat. Put it out there in the atmosphere. Jacob's trouble, my God, will not be your trouble. Determine now. If you ever determined a thing before, determine now that you are going to make this step and live faithfully as best you can for God. This is no time to play church, muck around, mess around, one foot in, one foot out. You're living for God, but you're not doing anything for God. Oh, woe betide that that axe falls on your neck. This is the time to get fully involved and make sure that you're living for Christ wholly. Father and God, I pray right now for every born-again Christian. I hold their hands. I squeeze that person's hand. I squeeze their hands by faith. And I'm asking right now, God, that you would ignite our hearts, not just to be lights in this world, but to be voices, that we will stand up with boldness and speak out on your behalf, speak for you, that we will not be afraid to warn others concerning the dark day that is at hand and the super storm that is approaching that will devastate all manner of livelihood on this planet. My God, I'm asking, oh, if they could see that the sea is turning to blood, if they could see that the moon is turning to blood, if they could see it right now, they would understand the severity of what we're talking about. If they could understand that so much blood is going to be shed in the battle of Armageddon, that the Bible says that the ocean will begin to have a reddish appearance. If they could understand that, they would understand what we're dealing with. These are cantankerous, dangerous times. And I'm asking God that you would help us to live for you wholly and solely. May we be true to our Lord and our Savior. May we support each other. May we have accountability partners in this walk. Men and women who will stand around us and behind us and help to correct us if we go astray. This is no time to try to make it on your own. You will not make it on your own. I hear the Lord say there are some who think that they're a law unto themselves, but God told me to tell you, no man is an island. You need your brother. Sir, you need your sister. Ma'am, you're going to need that sister, that brother. We need to connect with each other now more than ever before. We got to rally this thing together if we're going to make it out of this place in the rapture. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, God, help us to put away our indifferences and to capitalize and maximize the things that are most important, which is your soon return, that we may not have to face or furrow through this superstorm of Jacob's trouble. In the name of Jesus, I ask that. If you're not a born-again Christian, this is a good time for me to lead you in a sinner's prayer. I want you to look at me this morning, and I want you to pray this prayer with me right where you are. Pray like this: Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I sincerely believe that you are the only way, the only truth, the only life. I put my life in your hands. Thank you for saving me today. I trust in your shed blood for the forgiveness of all my sins. Lord Jesus, I turn everything over to you. I let go and I let God. In Jesus' mighty name today, your blood is what will save me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Christ's sake, I pray this way. Amen and amen. You prayed that prayer just now? God bless you. More power to you. I want to commend you, congratulate you, and I want you to tell somebody that you are born again Christian. Now your faith muscles will have to grow. A good way to start is to get on into the Word of God. Begin by reading the Gospels. Read St. John's Gospel. That's perhaps the easiest book in the Bible that you could pick up and read and understand straight away off the bat. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you, to guide you along. He will do that, and He will teach you His Word. I'd love to reconnect with you or connect with you, meet you. If you would, just drop me a message right on there in our inbox. I prefer to use the inbox. The Facebook inbox is a private. You don't have to worry about that. private message me, Facebook inbox. I'll be happy to interact with you, get in touch with you. Congratulations. If you made that decision today, God bless you from Calvary Temple Community Church right here in Grove Six Rows, Barbados. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dios te bendiga. God bless you. For all of my Spanish-speaking friends out there as well, across Nicaragua, Brazil, and several other Spanish-speaking places, we connect with you and you connect with us. So I know you're out there. We see you and we love you. Amen. Amen. I want to move right on into the communion table at this time. I invite you to go get your emblems if you haven't done so already, as we eat and drink to the glory of God today in full understanding and comprehending that Christ paid an awfully high price for our sins. Praise the Lord. With our emblems in our hands, I read 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, one of my favorite portions of Scripture whenever we approach God's communion table. This is not the table of a man or a fellowship. This is the table of Almighty God, our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Verse 23 and following, Apostle Paul writes, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do also in remembrance of me. After the same manner, he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death until he comes." This is a timely reminder coming on the heels of that message that you just heard, that Christ is coming again. "Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man or a woman examine themselves, and so let them eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to themselves, not discerning the Lord's body." Father, I bless these emblems that we hold right now. I join my faith with those of multiplied hundreds, perhaps thousands of persons who would now take their emblems in their hands. And together, the synergy of faith is sufficient, that every biscuit, every bit of bread, that emblem is just a symbol, a metaphor. And we bless it in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Likewise, that cup, dear God, it might be grape juice, it might be apple juice, orange juice. Some may just have a beverage of water. God, I ask right now that you would bless that symbol. It is a symbol. And I do pray, God, that as your glory would fall on us, by faith, as we eat and drink, we eat and drink life. We eat and drink vitality, strength to our bodies. Not only spiritual strength, but physical strength. And we exchange every pain, every bit of weight, every bit of despair, every bit of frustration, every bit of lack. My God, whatever we're each walking through today, we have this courage in knowing that we can lay it all down and take up what you purchased for us in dying on that cross and coming out of that cruel grave. Oh God, I thank you today that you are alive and you're coming again. And so we eat and drink today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go ahead and eat that bread. Mm-hmm. Mm. And now we partake of the cup. Drink ye all of it. Thank God. Thank God today that he rescued us on that cross. Thank God for the opportunity to take the communion not only with the online audience, but also with those who are in the studio today. As we ate and as we ate and drank to the glory of God and the benefit of our livelihood. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me take the opportunity then to conclude and furnish you with a benediction, thanking you, of course, for journeying with us today from Calvary Temple Community Online Church. Pastor Andre saying thank you so much for joining us. You could have chosen so many other platforms, but you chose to be with us. Thank you for streaming. Those of you who were on there on the Facebook page, thank you for following and liking that page. Don't jump off unless you do that. If you've not done that yet, just make a check. You may think you've done it, but you didn't do it. So just make a check. Make sure you follow, like the page. If you would jump on over onto YouTube as well, please go on over there and subscribe to our YouTube channel. There's no reason why you should only be on Facebook. We've got a significant number of persons, a very quickly growing family on Facebook. But I'd love to see those numbers also appearing on our YouTube channel. So God bless you. Thank you for treating to that. Those of you who've been faithful in your giving and your donating, sacrificial, even in your lack, reaching into your pockets, into your investments, and making the gospel spread from Calvary Temple Community Church, Barbados. Thank you so much for giving. Thank you for making it possible. Because you do what you do for God, we are able to do what we do for God. Amen? And it does cost to win the loss. Those of you who would like to participate in that effort, CIBC account savings number 7210312. Our CIBC savings account number 7210312. So from Calvary Temple Community Church, I declare blessings over you. Those of you who've been faithful in this regard in your giving, I pronounce, I bequeath blessing after blessing. More power to you. May the glory of God fall on your behalf. I pray favor in your investments, favor into your pocketbook, favor into your purse, into your wallet. I pray that the glory of the Lord will show up in your workplace. Those of you who have businesses, your entrepreneurs, I decree and declare today that God is opening new vistas for you. I speak that forth and drop it right on into your inbox in Jesus' mighty name. No other name but Christ's name. Amen. And amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. Look forward to reconnecting with you all next Sunday at 10 o'clock. We've got a special surprise for you. I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, but I suppose eventually it's going to come out anyhow. But we got a special surprise for you as we get ready to return to the house of the Lord, the edifice, the building for our main services. And that's coming up real soon. It doesn't mean that we're going to drop the online platform. No, we're going to marry the two and we're going to go forward with the live streaming. So we return to the house, to the edifice with the on-site, but we will also maintain the online. Somebody shout amen. Somebody declare glory to God. Plan now to be with us next Sunday evening, 6:30 p.m. Do not forget, that's July 12th, 6:30 p.m. for our Drive-In Church Experience Part 2. That's Drive-In Church Reloaded. Don't miss that for anything. Plan to come early. Like I told you, you should be here well in advance of 6:30 because there were scores of people, as you saw in the Nation newspaper, scores of people here half an hour before we even started. So I'd want you to get a good vantage point next Sunday evening. So from Calvary Temple, Pastor Andre saying, we love you so much. Share this video with someone right now. God bless you.
Thank you.